The telescope has seen almost continuous development in the last 400 years since its invention. We're inclined to take the human eye for granted, but it remains our most important research tool when used with a telescope. It's true that there's nothing we can do to improve the performance of the eye for astronomy, but there are a wide range of things we can do to make sure that the eye is operating optimally when we actually use it for astronomy. There are also things we can do to actually exploit the peculiar characteristics of the eye when we do astronomy as well. We're going to take a look at the eye in a little bit more detail using this model so that we can better understand the things that we can actually do with the eye when we present it to the eyepiece of a telescope. Let's take a closer look inside the eye. Let's just peel away the sclera, the outer layer of the eye, and open up the inside. Here we can see the iris, and we can see the hole there that it's controlled by the iris, letting light through to the lens, which then forms an image on the back of the retina. Very much the eye at this point is looking like a camera, with the iris at the front, and immediately behind that we've got the lens here that's producing the focused image onto the retina, which functions very much like a film. This structure represents the aqueous and vitreous humours inside the eye that keep the bulb of the eye inflated so that it doesn't collapse. And here we can now see inside onto the retina, which functions rather like the film in a camera. This is the actual part where the image is formed at the back here. Looks a little bit complicated. We've got a number of blood vessels here that are actually supplying blood to the retina. Important point to note here is this little spot on its own on the retina. I don't know whether you can see that clearly just here. This is the part of the retina where the cone cells, these light sensitive cells that actually send their signal to the brain, are at their most dense. These cells are particularly sensitive to colour and detail, and this is the part of the retina that you actually steer along a line of text when you're reading or placing over somebody's face when you recognise them. So this is the most detailed part of your vision. The area surrounding it on the back of the around the back of the eyeball here is another important part of the retina, and it's still densely packed with light sensitive cells. These are the rod cells that are responsible for the pora, the peripheral vision, and in particular it's the part of the vision that's very active at night when the light levels drop, because these cells are actually more sensitive to light than the cone cells. So these are very important to us as astronomers. We're just going to look at this in a little bit more detail in a photograph that's actually been taken of the retina here. This is an actual photograph of a living retina. Just a few salient points to draw to your attention here. You can see the optic nerve over there. We can see blood vessels supplying blood to the retina. And most importantly from our point of view, we can see the fovea here. This is where those colour and detail sensitive light cells are actually collected. This is the part that you actually steer around for facial recognition and when you're reading, and very important to us as astronomers, this is the part of the retina that you're using when you're looking at subtle planetary detail, when you're examining a lunar crater, something that's bright and got lots of detail on it. This is the part of the retina that you're actually using. Now, it's the area around that that's also of a lot of interest to us as astronomers, because that's where the even more sensitive cells are collected. The cells that are able to detect lower light levels. Also in this region are cells that are specialised for the detection of movement. There's a lot more to the retina than just these simple idea of these two types of film, the black and white film that is a larger portion of the retina, and then the colour, more detailed film centered around the fovea. It's a bit more sophisticated than that. The retina is actually brain tissue, and there are actual elements of perception going on this structure, the retina. Now, it's some of those ideas that we can actually exploit when we're at the eyepiece of a telescope. So let's look at some of those in a bit more detail now. Now, as astronomers, we can exploit this split functionality of the retina, the fact that we've got an area that is sensitive to detail and colour, the part that we steer when we're actually reading or face recognition, and then this area around it that is more sensitive but more like a black and white film. We can actually use what astronomers call averted vision by deliberately taking an interest in that peripheral vision rather than how we would normally look at something if we were reading a line of text. So it's a little bit like looking at one word on a line of text but taking an interest in the words on either side of it. Now it sounds difficult to do, but in actual fact with a little bit of practice it's quite easy at the eyepiece to take a particular interest in what's going on the periphery of the field of view of your vision without actually steering your eye to it. Practice it next time you're at the eyepiece of a telescope. Now, again, this split functionality provides us with another little trick that we can do to actually allow ourselves to be able to see fainter targets at the eyepiece. And that relies on the fact that this peripheral area, this black and white vision section of the retina, also has cells that are particularly sensitive to movement. And we can use that by moving the telescope. So exploiting this feature, if you're having difficulty getting the deep sky target to pop out from the sky background, having difficulty picking it up, just try a little gentle rocking movement by holding the RA knob and just rocking it backwards and forwards in your fingers. If that isn't quite enough to get the telescope moving, actually grab hold of the telescope lightly, perhaps by the front cell, and just subject it to a gentle rocking motion. Very gently just rock the telescope backwards and forwards, and ideally it'll provide you with an opportunity to see the edges of maybe the deep sky target, the galaxy or nebulae that you're actually looking at. While we're at the eyepiece of the telescope, let's just tell you about one of the simplest things you can do to improve your visual experience at the telescope and get you to see more, and that's keep both eyes open. Now I know that may seem a little bit strange when the telescope only has one eyepiece, but what you're going to find that if you actually approach the telescope and squint into it, what's actually going on here is that the electrical signals that control the muscles around the eye are actually going to leak over to the other side of your eye and cause the eyeball that's looking into the eyepiece to vibrate slightly. Now it turns out that there is a mechanism associated with the retina that when the eyeball is made to move at any point, it actually suppresses the signal that goes to the brain and allows you to actually see something. This is something that is actually useful when you're moving your eyes around rapidly. The amount of signal actually being sent to the brain is suppressed slightly. You can try this for yourself actually by squinting, taking an interest in the view that you're getting, and then simply covering one eye. You'll actually get a better view when you just cover one eye rather than squint. Take a look at this little demonstration. Cassandra is going to help us out by exercising her left eyelid and giving us a long, slow wink. The influence of the eye being closed on the open right eye is not that striking like this, but if we cover up the eye that's winking with a card so we can more easily detect the changes to the open right eye without being distracted, you can actually see that when she's winking now, you can see the influence on that open eye. She's both eyes open now, winking now. So you can see, keep both eyes open at the eyepiece. Another great feature of this split function of the retina, the fact that we've got one portion that deals with views in good lighting and in full colour with lots of detail, and this other type of film that we've got, this black and white, is that this sensitive black and white portion of the retina actually improves over time. In fact, in low light situations, it can take as long as 40 minutes for our dark adaptation to be able to see more detail in the dark to actually build up. Now, if it takes as long as 40 minutes, obviously we need to try to protect that. So, lights. So one of the best things we can do is make sure that we don't use white light. By using a pure red light source like this, we can be sure that we are providing the lowest level of illumination to our eyes to make sure that we can preserve our dark adapted vision. Just a word of warning, this is actually way too bright. We actually need to put several layers of brown tape on the front here to actually darken this down so that we want to be able to barely read by it rather than this very strong beam that we've got here that we're reading by. We need to be able to hold the torch really quite close to something that we're reading or to check the setting circles on a telescope. And one of the best ways we've found of doing that is adding a few layers of brown tape to the front of the torch there. Okay, let's have the lights back up again. Given the importance of dark adapted vision at the eyepiece of the telescope so that we can see very faint targets, it can be a good idea to actually start building up your dark adaptive vision even before you go out. That's taking a tip from the military there. Before they go out on nighttime ops, they sometimes use something like this, which is a pair of red goggles, and you can put those on. These ones actually flip up so that I can actually see what I'm doing. And using these goggles, even during an observing session, you can actually go indoors to make a cup of tea or something like that. But actually using them 30 minutes before we go out allows us to actually develop dark adapted vision. As to what your neighbours are going to think about you if they see you creeping around wearing this kind of gear in preparation for an observing session, I'm happy to leave that to your imagination.
Boo.